So I must say, Terry, with her last story, definitely, I actually still suffer from the sweats that she had as a 13-year-old. So you'll have to excuse me. I'm wearing a velvet blazer, but I'm pulling it off. So I'm keeping it on, you know, throughout this story. So, you know, we're talking about glorious days tonight. And glorious days, when I think of them, I actually, I just got married recently. You all can clap now. Thank you. But I'm not going to talk about my wedding. What I'm going to talk about is a story from, my wedding was glorious, don't get me wrong, but just, I think the days that you can't quantify, the days that you don't see coming, those days that, you know, you're rounding a curve and there they are right when you round them, those are the days that can really be glorious, you know, those kind of just wonderful, you know, just out of nowhere days. And one of those days actually happened to me when I was studying abroad in London, England. You guys familiar with London, England? It's a, you know, across the seas. We fought a war against them and independence is great. So London, England, I was there, freshman year of college. I was studying abroad. And one of the things we always used to like to do when we were studying abroad was we wanted to experience things that we could only see in places that we were. So, you know, we would go to Ireland and we would, you know, go visit St. Patrick's. We would go to, you know, the Guinness Storehouse. Excellent. We would just have a great time. And in London, one of the, you know, very unique places that we could see, nowhere else on the planet could see this, was Hard Rock Cafe. Now, of course, you can actually see, you know, Hard Rocks all across the world, but the very first one is in London, England. And we decided to go to the Hard Rock Cafe. It's my roommates and myself. We all went one night, and the nice thing about the London one is they actually have a vault underneath. And in this vault, you can go in and you can find, you know, just all the pieces of rock memorabilia you would ever want to see. So I know Luke earlier was talking about, you know, a rock concert and like seeing the band and everything like this. This was like that on crack. It was fantastic. It was insane. Like, we were going in, we were seeing Pete Townsend's guitar, we were seeing Miles Davis's trumpet, we were seeing John Coltrane's saxophone. Literally, name any, like, insert name of master musician here, insert their article that they played with, and also, you know, their hats, their coats, their, you know, really everything you'd want to see and more. So we decided to go in and see this wonderful museum that they have underneath the Hard Rock in London. And when we go in there, they actually, the first night that I went there with my roommates, this is the people that I went with originally to London, they had a tour guide. And this tour guide, the best way I can describe him, he dressed a lot like, you know, like kind of like Axl Rose. But he was actually more kind of like an irritable fascist librarian in terms of his mindset. Because his mindset was, you know, when you get down there and you see all this awesome rock and roll like type stuff, it was, okay, pick up one instrument at a time, hold it, take a photo, hold 5 seconds, ready? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right, photo, you're good, go, move on. So this was, that he actually counted off multiple times. It was kind of ridiculous. And this is Axl Rose dressed up like that yelling at us. So, you know, I got up, I held up my one guitar, smiled sheepishly, you know. And, you know, it took 5 seconds, I'm out. You know, photo done, you know, you're good. So, you know, first night, you know, Axel Mussolini guides us through this tour guide, you know, like puts us through everything. And, you know, that's our night, that's our evening. You know, we get all our photos taken, it's a good night. Now, that wasn't, you know, a glorious day. That's a tour guide through, you know, the vaults of Hard Rock London. But the glorious day comes up later. So several of my very good friends from high school are visiting me. And I decide, hey, even though, you know, I went through this fascist popsicle stand the first time, like, I'm taking them another time. We're going to have a good time. So we decide to go one night. And, you know, with Hard Rock, you know, one of the things is you go in, you're having your burgers, your drinks that are the size of a human head. They're excellent. You know, they're very exciting. All kinds of liquors filled in. We're all 18, so, you know, we don't know much about that. So we're hanging out, and we decide to go to the vault. I walk up to, you know, approach the store, you know, and that's the store controls the vault area, and they inform us that they're closed, you know. And they say they're closed. It was 8 o'clock at night, you know, it was like 8:05, and they're like, we just closed. The last tour was at 8 o'clock. I'm like, last tour was at 8 o'clock? You know, this is a hard rock and roll doesn't close at 8 o'clock. What are you talking about? Rock and roll stays open all night. I mean, at least that's what I've been told. I am not entirely familiar, but you people should know. 8 o'clock, are you kidding me? So, you know, I'm talking to, you know, the manager of the store, and I'm saying to her, you know, look, my friends, they're in town. Now, this was their second night in town. They were in town for 6 nights, but, you know, I'm taking some license with the fact that this is the night we portioned to visiting Hard Rock, and I'm going, this is their last night in town. Like, they're not going to be here much longer. How are we going to see all this amazing rock memorabilia when you're withholding it from us? Because rock and roll closes at 8 o'clock. And she's going, you know, she's going, look, the tour guide, you know, Axel Mussolini, he left early. He's gone for the night. He's off to some sort of rally. And we're just like, all right, well, is there anyone else that can take us down? And I see this guy, you know, young English gentleman over here in the corner. And he's, you know, been off for a couple times. He's drinking, you know, a couple of those human head-sized cocktails, you know, taking them down, really enjoying himself. And he goes, I could take him down. And I'm just going to call him, you know, a proper English name like Pedro. Pedro is, you know, over here in the corner. And he's going, hey, I could take him down there. And he's like, you know, slurring, like, I could take him down. Yeah, I got it. And we're like, Pedro could take us down. You could see the manager is like, I do not want Pedro taking these people down to the Hard Rock Vault. The Hard Rock Vault is pure priceless memorabilia, and she does not. Pedro should be here, and the Hard Rock Vault should be here. I'm stepping away from the microphone to say it. That's how much distance they should have from one another. They should be nowhere near one another, but she doesn't want them combining. But I seize on Pedro's moment. I go, hey, Pedro can take us down. I didn't say Pedro. It's just, you know, artistic license with the moment. So I say he could take us down. And she goes, all right, he can take you down. So we, you know, we troop down the stairs, and we're walking our way down. And, you know, before, you know, it was hold one instrument, you know, take a photo, and you're done. If you, God forbid, you should try to play the instrument, you were going to be brained over the head with a bass guitar within 5 seconds. There was no way you were going to make it out of there alive. So we get down there with Pedro, and Pedro, you know, he's on his third Long Island iced tea. He's having a good time. Nowhere near here as good as the drinks at Victory Brewing Company. I know, right? But, you know, he's on his third LIT. He's having a nice time. And Pedro is just like, hey, pick up whatever you want, man. We're like, you serious? Like, we were taken aback at first. We were like, he gave us, you know, the keys to the kingdom, and we were just cautiously stepping in. Because when someone grants you the keys to the kingdom, there's got to be a catch, you know? There wasn't one. So Pedro just lets us in, and, you know, within about 2 minutes, you know, I'm wearing Kurt Cobain sunglasses from that one album, you know, the white sunglasses. My one buddy, actually, Alex, is over here in the audience. He's wearing Bob Dylan's hat. You know, we're actually, you know, one friend's playing Miles Davis's trumpet. My one friend, Bill, picks up Pete Townsend's guitar and plays Pinball Wizard. We all start singing along. Pedro doesn't know any of the words, but he's joining in. Which, I mean, I don't know. I thought part of being English was knowing the Who's music. But that's, hey, you know, whatever. He's a prince of a man in my book. So, you know, we're all singing along. You know, another guy picks up Stevie Ray Vaughan's guitar, starts playing Guitar Hurricane. And the whole night just kind of focused around the fact that it's, you know, just six different friends. I miscounted already. Six different friends enjoying an evening together, enjoying time that can only be, you know, something that I'm going to tell in a story, you know, nearly a decade later now. God, I feel old. Nearly a decade later now. And it's one of those things where glorious days, they come at you anytime, and you've just always got to be ready to catch them. And, you know, from the birth of a child to holding up your little sister at a rock concert, you know, we always just got to be ready to recognize when those things come around the bend, and we always got to be ready to receive them. And I hope you guys are having a good night tonight. Thank you.